We're just being depressurized. We're going to maintain 10,000, and we need to return back to Portland.
January 5th, 2024. Alaska Airlines Flight 1282 had just departed from Portland, Oregon, heading south to Ontario, California. On board were 171 passengers and 6 crew members. The weather was clear. The takeoff was smooth. The flight was expected to last just over 2 hours. Short, smooth, uneventful. At least that's how it started. But just minutes into the climb, something went terribly wrong.
The first indication was it was an explosion in my ears. And then a whoosh of air. My body was forced forward, and there was a loud bang.
A section of the cabin wall, about the size of a refrigerator, suddenly blew off. Passengers screamed. The cabin filled with freezing air. Phones, seat cushions, and even clothing were nearly sucked into the sky. One teenager's shirt was torn completely off. Miraculously, no one was seated next to the hole. But here's the twist. This wasn't caused by turbulence, or a bird strike, or even sabotage. The reason was much deeper than that. So what really happened on Flight 1282? How did a brand new jet suffer such a massive failure mid-air? And why did this force the FAA to ground planes all around the world? Stick around, because what we found in the investigation is truly shocking. It was a calm winter evening in Portland, Oregon. At Portland International Airport, everything looked routine. The sun had just set and the air was cool. Gates were busy. Ground crews were moving quickly. Flights were coming and going without delay. At gate C9, passengers were boarding Alaska Airlines Flight 1282. The destination? Ontario, California. It was a short flight down the West Coast. The aircraft involved was a Boeing 737 MAX 9. It was just 2 months old. Fresh paint, new seats, clean cabin. To most passengers, it looked like a perfect ride. Inside, there were 177 people with crew members, families, business travelers, teens heading back from the holidays. At the front of Alaska Airlines Flight 1282, two seasoned aviators were in command. The captain was no rookie. With over 12,700 total flight hours, including 6,500 on Boeing 737s, he was a veteran in the skies. Calm under pressure. Steady hands. Trusted with hundreds of lives, day after day. Sitting beside him in the right seat was First Officer Emily Whiprude. She brought 8,300 hours of flying experience to the cockpit, including 1,500 hours on the Boeing 737. Together, they made up a highly skilled, well-trained team, one that Alaska Airlines counted on every day. Before we continue, if you're enjoying this video, please consider subscribing to stay updated on more interesting aviation stories. At 5:06 p.m., Flight 1282 pushed back from Gate C9 at Portland International Airport. The takeoff was smooth. Runway 28 left. Wheels up at 5:07. Climb rate was stable. Engines were strong. Cabin pressure was normal. But just 6.5 minutes later, as the jet leveled out near 14,300 feet, everything changed. A loud, violent bang shook the aircraft. The aircraft had suffered an uncontrolled decompression. A plug installed to cover an unused emergency exit had blown off the side of the plane, leaving a gaping hole near row 26. Inside the cabin, chaos erupted. Oxygen masks dropped. Wind screamed through the fuselage. A teenage boy's shirt was torn from his body. His mother clung to him with all her strength, afraid the wind might take him too. Passengers near the breach grabbed anything they could, armrests, seat backs, just to stay grounded. Items like cushions, phones, clothing were sucked out into the freezing atmosphere. The hole was just inches from seat 26A. Thankfully, it was unoccupied. In the cockpit, the master caution flashed red. The crew reacted instantly, trying to stabilize the aircraft, donning oxygen masks, scanning for system failures. But even they were physically affected. By 5:13 p.m., the aircraft had reached its highest point, 16,320 feet. The pilots quickly reacted. The cockpit warning lights were flashing. The master caution had already been triggered. Inside the cockpit, chaos broke out. The cockpit door blew open, slamming into a lavatory door and jamming. The first officer's headset flew off, and the captain's was knocked out of place. Even their laminated quick reference checklist was sucked into the passenger cabin. Realizing the danger, the pilots immediately set a new course. They adjusted the autopilot to descend to 10,000 feet. It is the safe breathing altitude. The nose of the aircraft tilted down. By 5:16 p.m., they began a sharp left turn to return to Portland. Flight attendants helped passengers move away from the damaged section. Some seats were visibly wrecked, the seat backs torn, tray tables missing, cushions gone. Rows 25 through 27 were the worst hit. At 5:17 p.m., the plane dropped below 10,000 feet, and the cabin pressure began to stabilize. Breathing became easier. The roar of the wind eased. The fear remained. Finally, at 5:26 p.m., just 20 minutes after takeoff, the plane touched down safely back in Portland. Fire crews rushed aboard. Three passengers and one crew member needed medical attention for minor injuries. Several carry-on items had been lost to the sky. But remarkably, everyone was alive. But it could have been so much worse. When Flight 1282 touched down safely in Portland, many hoped the worst was over. But in reality, it was only the beginning. By that same evening, Alaska Airlines took immediate action. They grounded their entire fleet of 65 Boeing 737 MAX 9s, fearing there could be more hidden dangers. The next day, January 6th, 18 of those jets were cleared by Alaska for service. They had recently gone through maintenance, and their door plugs had already been checked. But that relief didn't last long. Later that day, the Federal Aviation Administration stepped in. They issued an emergency airworthiness directive. It wasn't just about Alaska Airlines anymore. It was every 737 MAX 9 with a mid-cabin door plug. They were all grounded. United Airlines, Copa Airlines, Turkish Airlines, Lion Air, all forced to pull their planes from the sky. Even Europe got involved. On January 7th, the European Union Aviation Safety Agency adopted the FAA directive. But the impact wasn't just physical, it was legal too. On January 11th, six passengers filed a class action lawsuit against Boeing citing emotional trauma, physical injuries, and sheer terror. And the airline chaos continued. From January 12th to 21st, Alaska Airlines was forced to cancel over 100 flights per day. Tens of thousands of passengers were left scrambling. Airline staff were overwhelmed. Then came another twist. On January 21st, the FAA extended its concerns beyond just the MAX 9. They recommended checks on the older model, a plane that had flown safely for over 11 million hours, but used the same type of door plug. Even a plane with a perfect record was now under the microscope. Finally, a sliver of light broke through. On January 24th, the FAA approved a new inspection method. If a plane passed, it could return to service. By January 26th and 27th, Alaska and United began flying their MAX 9s again. But the damage had been done. By April, Boeing paid $160 million to Alaska Airlines as compensation. Globally, payouts topped $443 million. And now, with fear rising and trust in Boeing shaken, the world needed answers. So what really caused this mid-air disaster? And was it just one airplane or something much bigger? The night Alaska Airlines Flight 1282 landed safely back in Portland, investigators were already mobilizing. The attention quickly turned to one urgent question. How did a large section of the plane's wall just blow out mid-flight? The National Transportation Safety Board immediately launched an investigation. Their chair, Jennifer Homendy, took charge of the case. But this wasn't just an NTSB matter. The FAA, Alaska Airlines, Boeing, and the unions representing pilots, flight attendants, and aircraft workers all joined in. Even the FBI and the Department of Justice got involved because what happened wasn't just an accident. It could have been a serious crime. As investigators started looking deeper, more red flags appeared. The same aircraft had shown signs of trouble days before the incident. On December 7th, January 3rd, and January 4th, the cockpit displayed a warning message: auto fail. This meant the plane's automatic cabin pressurization system had stopped working properly. Thankfully, a backup system kicked in each time, and the flights continued without issues. But because of this warning, Alaska Airlines had already decided the plane shouldn't fly over the ocean just in case. Still, no one had figured out the real problem before January 5th. Then came a major discovery. Just 2 days after the accident, someone in Cedar Mill, Oregon, found the missing door plug in their backyard. This was the panel that had blown off the plane at 16,000 feet. Two passengers' cell phones were also found in separate locations, one lying near a road and the other in someone's yard. But one crucial piece of evidence was lost forever: the plane's cockpit voice recorder, known as the CVR, records over itself every 2 hours. Since no one pulled the circuit breaker to stop the recording, the audio from the actual incident was erased. Investigators were frustrated. This could have revealed what the pilots were saying during the blowout. The NTSB chair immediately called for longer voice recordings, up to 25 hours, to prevent this kind of loss in future cases. Boeing's CEO, Dave Calhoun, held a meeting with employees and admitted there had been a serious failure in quality control. He called it a quality escape, a term that means something went wrong during manufacturing and wasn't caught before the plane was delivered. Inside the NTSB lab, investigators examined the door plug. What they found confirmed their worst fears. There were no bolts securing the plug at the time of the accident. It had likely been installed without them. The plug had moved upward, cleared the stops meant to hold it in place, and blew out of the aircraft. On February 6th, the NTSB released their preliminary report. It clearly stated the door plug had been reinstalled without the required bolts. Boeing's own records suggested the plug had been removed during manufacturing and never properly secured again. But even more concerning was what happened next. In March, the NTSB reported to Congress that security footage of the door plug installation, footage that could have shown whether bolts were used or not, had been automatically deleted. Boeing said this was part of their routine process, but to many, it felt like another failure in a chain of oversights. In August, the NTSB held a public hearing to go over the evidence so far. But just before that, Boeing shared confidential details of the investigation with reporters. As a result, the NTSB stopped giving Boeing access to new updates. As the investigation continues, the world watches Boeing more closely than ever. Lawsuits have been filed. Compensation has been paid. Planes have returned to service. But trust? That's harder to rebuild. Because this wasn't just a technical failure, it was a human one. What happened on Alaska Airlines Flight 1282 wasn't just a close call, it was a wake-up call. But what do you think? Let us know your thoughts in the comments. If you found this story interesting, make sure to subscribe and turn on the bell so you don't miss what's coming next. Thanks for watching, and as always, safe travels.